PC builders. Our outline, we're gonna learn about the PC hardware and how to troubleshoot it. This serves dual purpose, the A+ obviously that everyone's in, and the PC clinic, if we ever get computers in that are not turning on physically, not functioning, not booting up, we'll learn how to diagnose them. All right, so start off. The computer has a brain. The brain is called a processor. Here's one of the older processors. I'm gonna pass it around. On the processor itself, there's some information, and we're gonna cover that information in just a little bit, how to read it, and so on and so forth. Did you want you to look at the pins on the bottom? And we're gonna pass on a different one. This one's a little bit newer. I'm gonna bring it in closer to the camera. It has writing on it that we're about to talk about, and then it has a lot of pins going down the side. It has a notch where there's pins missing. It has a little arrow pointing on the same notch. This is the computer's brain. This is what does all the thinking. This is a little bit newer one that I'm sending around. All right, processors, there's two brands of processors. There's Intel and AMD. For some reason, each one classifies their processors by different classifications. This one uses gigahertz, this one uses kilohertz. For instance, the AMD processor that I passed around was 1,800 kilohertz. Go back. 1,800 kilohertz, which is equivalent to 1.8 gigahertz. Okay, so there's 1,000 kilohertz in a single gigahertz. A simple way to translate it is to just change the comma. For instance, if I had 2,700 kilohertz, that's 2,700, right? Just take the comma, make it into a period, and you've got a 2.7, that's a 2, there it is, 2.7 gigahertz, and vice versa. If you have a 1.2 gigahertz processor, it's equivalent to what? 1,200 kilohertz processor, okay? All right, now, this is known as the capacity, and we'll talk about it in just a minute. The next thing I wanna talk about is this hyperthreading right here. Intel has a technology called hyperthreading that allows your processor to do two jobs simultaneously, okay? To do two processes at the exact same time. All right, now let's talk about what's written on the back of these processors and what does it mean. So first and foremost, we see here that we have our manufacturer. Okay, that's all that is. That's the MFG. That's who made this processor. We have a copyright year right there. Copyrighted 2004 tells you the year of the processor as well. And then we have this part right here. This is a model, also known as the family. This one's kind of weird because 640 is actually part of the model. There's a Pentium 4, and then there's a Pentium 4 640. It's just another model. There's different models. For instance, Intel has, if you would think of this as a car, this would be Ford, you know, that would be the manufacturer, and then this would be like the Impala. Okay, I'm sorry, that's a Chevy. A Ford, what's a Ford car? Mustang. Ford Mustang, oh, okay, nice car. All right, so the Ford Mustang. There's different models. For instance, you can't compare a Ford Mustang with a Ford Focus, right? That's two totally different cars. Same thing with the models. There's, as far as Intel models, there's some as small as the Atom, which is a processor that uses very little energy, low consumption energy, usually found in little netbooks in third world countries just because of the power, the small power consumption. There's Pentium, there's Celerons. Pentium actually has several models. There's a Pentium 1, Pentium 2, Pentium 3, Pentium 4, like you see, and then a Pentium 4 640. There's a Xeon processor, the Xeon family. There's the i5 and the i7 families, and so on. There's different models. The models, there's some models that are just much better than other models. For like I said, you wouldn't consider a a Mustang, a Ford Mustang, it might have five or six cylinders with a six cylinder, maybe a Ford Focus, you know, or another model of a car. Even though they're both six cylinders, they're still, it doesn't mean that they're the same power car. Just because they both have the same capacity here, a 3.2 i7 is not the same as a 3.2 Atom, okay? So the model is very important. Some models are just much higher end than others. The next one that we got here is what I just highlighted right here. That's the capacity. This right here, I explained it as, this is how much the processor can think at any point in time. This is how much, this is how big his brain is. Okay, that's how much he can hold at any point in time. You'll quickly find out that I draw processors like this. Okay, like the think tank on top, that's the size of the brain right up here. That would be the 3.2 gigahertz. That's how big his brain is. Okay, that's the capacity. Now that you've got your brain, and this is just what's encompassing, what you see in these outside lines, that's just the physicalness. That's the actual physical processor chip, okay? There's nothing special about the physical processor chip. Now that you got your capacity, and that's how much he can think at any single given time, it's written frequencies, just so that you know, the gigahertz is a frequency. Now that you know how much he can think at any single point in time, we can apply the rest. The next, we've got let's go on this one. This is the bus speed. 800 bus speed. That 800 means how fast can I connect to the motherboard? Because your processor is connected to your motherboard, right? So the connection between them, the connection from the motherboard to the processor, how fast can I send data up to the processor, that is your bus speed. So the bus speed depends on both of them. Okay, if your processor is rated for an 800 megahertz bus speed, then you need a motherboard that can support the same. If your motherboard was only rated for 400, how fast would I be able to send data? 400. So do I need to spend extra money for 800 bus speed? No, I don't, because my motherboard can't push it that fast. They need to match the bus speed, okay? Also known as the front side bus. All right, the next one right here is your cache. That's C-A-C-H-E. Connection from the motherboard to the processor isn't like a water hose where it's a constant flow, okay? It's more like spurts, like if you had a water hose and you were going like this, you were just sending little spurts, okay? And those are data packets that are going up through the front side bus. If the front side bus would be this guy, that's how thick that water hose is. That's your front side bus. That's the bigger your water hose is, the faster you can send data through, right? What this cache would be is, how much data can I send at any single point in time through the bus speed? So if there were packets, if you had a higher cache, 2 megs, that's how big that packet would be. If you had a smaller cache, if you only had 1 meg or half, then you'd send smaller packages at a time to the processor, okay? So all together, the bus speed, the cache, and the capacity, that's how fast the processor is. Not one is more important than the other. Okay, not only do you need to be able to think a whole lot at a single point in time, you need to have a good connection to get data up and down into the processor. And if you have really large cache, you can send really big packets at a time, therefore getting more things done quickly. Okay, so this right here all has to do with the speed of that processor. Okay. Next, what we've got right there, this right here is the step code, right there. The step code is like the VIN number to a car. It's specifically for that car. It's like a serial number, sort of. you can find everything you need to know about a processor using the step code. Okay. For instance, there were some processors that wouldn't have any information on them whatsoever written on here except for the step code. You can then go to the website of that manufacturer, type in the step code, and get all the information. Then you find out the cache, the front side bus, the capacity all at once, just from the step code. Okay. Next one that we've got right here, that's simple. That's just, you know, where it was made, Costa Rica. And then the rest of the numbers are non-important. All right. Any questions on reading the processor? No? All right. Let's move on. Now let's go back to that hyper-threading. You know, how does hyper-threading work? I told you it's a process where the processor can do two things at once. Okay? So let's draw a processor here. And I have my single processor. And then I have data coming into my processor, right? The way processors work, they're just giant calculators. They're just think tanks. They just solve mathematical equations all day long. So when these packets come up, they're just mathematical equations or a problem that it resolves and then sends out. Okay, so it resolves, sends out. So there's a line. If you thought of this, this would be the mathematician in the middle. And then these would just be people that are in line that have the problems to be solved. Okay, so the one would come up, it'd solve the problem, go next. Solve the problem, go next. Solve the problem, go next. The difference with hyperthreading is that if you had the same room with the mathematician in the middle, or the brain, and then you wouldn't have a single line of people, you would actually have two lines of people. Okay? And he would be answering both answers at the same time. He'd be giving you both answers at the same time. Both answers at the same time. Both answers at the same time. Okay? Now, this it's sort of like an optical illusion. Let me give you a pop quiz now. It's sort of a trick question, not really. Is this a faster processor? You're reluctant now because I told you it's sort of a trick question, right? So what would you say, yes or no?
I say yes.
Everybody say yes? No, why not?
I say yes.
Just because I said it's a what do you think this is a faster processor? The answer is no, but yes, okay? Let me tell you why no. All right, so let's say this is a 3 gigahertz processor, okay? And this is a 3 gigahertz processor. Is it any faster?
No.
No, it's the brain is the same size. Let's say this is an 800 front side bus, 800 front side bus. Is it any faster?
No.
No? Let's say my cache is 2 megs, and my cache is 2 megs. Is it any faster?
No.
No. So is it really a faster processor? No. If this was a car and this car ran at 200 miles per hour, well, this is also a car and this car runs at 200 miles per hour. Okay, they're actually the same as fast. The reason this could be perceived as faster is because this is a car that runs 200 miles per hour, but it can go two ways at the same time. Okay, so it's actually solving more mathematical equations per minute. But technically, it's not a faster processor, right? It is getting more things done, but it's not any faster. Does that make any sense? Okay. If this took 1 second per question, this would be going 1 question per second, and this would be going 2 questions per second. Okay. So it's getting more done, but it's not any faster, if that makes any sense.
Well,
true speed would be measured by this, the red. That's really the true speed. It's not really any faster. This right here is just the output. It's outputting more, but it's really not any faster. This right here, in order for you to enable hyperthreading, there's a couple things that need to be going on. One, it needs to be an Intel processor. Only Intel can do this. AMD cannot do the hyperthreading. Two, both your processor and your motherboard must support hyperthreading. Okay, they both need to support hyperthreading. If you got a processor that does hyperthreading but a motherboard that doesn't, kind of out of luck. The good thing for you, as if that motherboard supports a certain processor, then it will more than likely support hyperthreading. Okay. And then 30, you got to turn it on. A lot of BIOS will allow you to turn it off, but for the most part, it's on by default, but you got to turn it on in the BIOS. You got to enable that function. The only time you'd want to turn it off is if maybe you want to conserve energy for some reason. You're on a long plane flight, there's no charger or whatever. All right. So now that we know sort of how hyperthreading works, hyperthreading has, you know, two lines of data that's being solved. Let's talk about the cored processors, because we've heard of dual core and quad core and all these other cores, multi-core processors. The difference between cores would look like this. If we had a dual core processor, let's say this, just for namesakes, we'll call this AMD. Okay, and we had a dual core processor. It's a processor, physically, it looks like one. There's no difference about it physically. But internally, inside, it's got two brains inside. Okay? So if it had two brains, how many lines of data would be lined up for each core? Just one per core, right? So I would have one for there and one for there. Math problems going up two single lines. Now what if I had a dual core processor, which means there's two cores, with hyperthreading? Now what I've got going on?
Two for each.
Two for each, that's right. One, two, one, two. So now I've got four lines, or four threads, going into my processor. Four, the lines is called threads. There's four threads going to my processors. If there's a math problem, it has four to pick from. Whichever has the least one, that's the one I'll go to, okay? The way Windows or computer would see this, it wouldn't know the difference between a multi-thread or a multi-core. He just counts threads. He doesn't know if it's two threads because you're doing hyper-threading or if you're doing two threads because you have two cores. He doesn't know the difference, okay? So this right here can be either a dual-core processor with hyper-threading or a quad-core processor. Does that make sense? Because if this was a quad-core processor, it would look like this. One, two, three, four, right? Four brains inside. And then it would have four lines of threads. If this was a dual-core processor with hyper-threading, this is a dual-core, this is a quad-core. If this was a dual-core with hyper-threading, it would look like that. Now, which one is best?
They're the same. Oh,
you say they're the same? You agree? Which one would you prefer? A quad-core processor or a dual-core processor with hyper-threading?
I would actually prefer the quad-core.
That's right. Each brain is dedicating full 100% to a single problem versus each brain being dedicated 50% here, 50% there, okay? The way the computer sees it, whether you've got this or that, they're gonna give you four threads on your performance right here. Now, me, by looking at this, I can tell, or let me ask you this, what do you think is going on right here? Do you think it's this or do you think it's that? Any guesses? Okay, any other guesses?
I say this.
Okay. This is actually this right here going on. And I'll show you why. These two are one single processor, okay? And you might notice it now, but there's a pattern there. That means it's not being used right here, so it's dead. It spikes up a little bit, drops down dead, spikes up a little bit, drops down, spikes up, drops down. You see it? But the way hyperthreading works is that if there's not a whole lot going on, because if you notice, if I make a line right there, now this part right here on top looks like this part, doesn't it? Right? It's flat line, flat line, flat line, flat line. It only activates that secondary thread if there's stuff going on. Okay? Now if you look at this one, this is the second processor. This one, if I make the line way up here, now it looks like that one, doesn't it? Because what I've got going on is dead, spike, and then dead, and then dead, spike, and then dead. Okay. This one, you notice that it actually went a little bit higher, and the first processor took care of any initial. Once it spiked this across a certain area, then the secondary thread kicked in. Okay. And that's how I would be able to tell that this is a dual-core processor with hyper-threading. If there was a quad-core, then like all four of them would be even moving kind of evenly. Okay. Different ones being used, other ones not being used, you know, and so on. So, any questions with this so far? No? Do we understand the difference between hyper-threading and non-hyper-threading? Dual-core or single-core or multi-core? All right, now I need one brave volunteer. One brave volunteer. Yes. All right, I need you to draw a six-core processor with hyper-threading. Yes. Draw big, real big.
Okay.
There you go.
Sorry.
You good? Right there. Okay. Now go ahead. All right. So how many threads do you have total?
12.
12. And if you were to look at this computer with 12 threads, you would actually see 12 of these little blocks going across like this. Okay? All right. Good job. Any questions on processors overall so far? No? We're not in troubleshooting yet. We'll get to troubleshooting in a little bit. All right. So now these processors are the brain. The processors do all the thinking. All the thunking, and they get hot. This is the hottest piece of the computer, and I really mean the hottest piece. You could probably fry an egg on it, okay? These computers, or these motherboards, internally have a sensor that if this overheats or gets beyond a certain temperature, it just shuts off to protect the equipment. Okay, if it didn't shut off, it would just burn, fire, and so on. Fire, 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 not good. Now, what we use are heat sinks or a cooling method to cool it down so that it doesn't overheat. The most common is this right here. It's a heat sink and fan. There's a heat sink, which is this metal plate right here. And heat sinks come in all sorts of shapes and colors. You even see a little heat sink right there built in. It's just metal. And believe it or not, there is a mathematical equation there to explain how heat sinks work. I'll break it down real easy because I don't understand this mathematical equation there. But it takes 100% heat and disperses it to, let's say, 10% heat, right? So it's 100% heat right here, disperses it down to 10% heat, and then a fan cools off 10% heat easier than it does cooling off 100% heat. Simple to understand. All right, so like I said, there's different shapes and sizes. This is just the most common one. As you can see, there's the big block right there, and then all the little thin lines in order for it to cool off. And then the fan on top cools off the little thin lines on top. Now, if you're ever just kind of wondering if your computer's way too hot, because sometimes if you get a computer who's doing way too much, it's too much for this little heat sink and fan. There's DC power going through this, so you're okay to touch it while it's running. What I usually do is I put my fingers right at the base of the heat sink. And if it's hot, then it's supposed to be hot. But if it's way too hot, like it burn you, then it's probably not a good thing. But the way you test it is, you touch it at the bottom, and then you slide your fingers to the top. When you touch it at the top, it should be much cooler at the top, because remember, the fan isn't cooling off the bottom, it's only cooling off the top edges. So if it's kind of cool at the top, then it's doing its thing. It's working just fine. But if it's the same as hot in the bottom as it is in the top, then this little fan is not cooling off the tips like it's supposed to. Okay, and then you better look into getting a better heat sink and fan. Okay, or you can just go to Fry's or somewhere and get yourself an actual sensor. You just put it on there with some scotch tape and it gives you an actual reading on it. Once you've got the actual reading, you look up your processor and look at its normal operating temperature and just make sure that your reading is within the temperature of the normal operating of whatever specs this processor was sold at, okay? All right, so if it does get too hot, you got two options. You can either get a much bigger heat sink or a much stronger fan, or you can switch to something known as water cooling. Water cooling works a lot like a car radiator works, and I mean a lot like it. There's a pump that's pumping water, there's a radiator where that water is going through, and then there's a fan cooling off the water, and then it's cycling all over again. So you've got cool water kind of running through this radiator, right? And then there's some kind of fan system blowing it off to make sure it's cool, okay? And then that cool water runs through the pipe, and then it splashes across there's a little chamber inside, and that chamber sits on top of right here, okay? The water doesn't actually touch this, it's within the chamber. But then it runs through the chamber, and this piece right here, it's heating up the chamber, but then the cold water cools off that chamber. Once the cool water runs through that chamber, that cool water becomes hot water. Okay? That hot water runs back to the radiator, circles through, gets cooled off by the air, and rotates all over again. So it's just water rotating, just like a car radiator system. Okay? Now, when this first came out, it was kind of like a cool thing. You'd even get clear pipes so you could see the liquid flowing through there. You'd have to get probably a pump about as big as this, and then that pump, you'd have to manually attach the tubes to your reservoir if you had one. Then the reservoir could be a little bigger, and then the reservoir would then go to the radiator, which probably would hang off your computer somewhere, and then from the radiator would run to the little chamber that sits on top of your processor, and then right back to the pump. So you had all these different pieces that you had to buy separately, put all the pipes together, and hope you didn't have a leak. Today, though, they're much, much nicer. You see, it's an all-in-one unit. You buy it just the way you see it. The pump, the radiator, everything's built in. And it's super small. It fits inside the computer now. Before, you had all these pipes sticking out of the computer. Now, it's a very small unit. Here, we have a standard heat sink and fan that just sits right on top of your computer. And then here, you have your cooling system. This is probably about $80, okay, one of the cheaper water cooling systems. There's a radiator, the fan is built right into the radiator, comes right on top of this little chamber. The water is inside this chamber, and you see this copper piece right here? This copper piece is what is on top of your processor that is transferring the heat. The reason it's copper is because copper transfers heat very, very well. But to help it out even more, we use thermal grease. We put thermal grease right there, and it comes in a little syringe like that. Sometimes it comes like a little ketchup package. You just rip it and put the thermal grease right on there. And then you just sit that right on top of this. And that thermal grease will bond the processor to that chamber so that the heatness from the processor will transfer quickly to the chamber. Okay, so that there's no lag of heat disbursement there. You use the thermal grease right down here as well, right on on this guy, you can see that this one, actually, the thermal grease got so hot that it just burnt right off. But that used to be thermal grease right there. But you put the thermal grease on there and just put it on there. Okay, and it's just a bond. It helps bond them so that the heat transfers from the processor to the heat sink much quicker, okay, and efficiently. Regardless of what you use, you need thermal grease. The best one is this one that has like little silver leaf or something they call it, inside of it, just to transfer the heat better. All right, any questions on cooling? No? Moving on to RAM, another piece of important equipment. So I'm looking for my older RAM, which I can't find. All right, there's different types of RAM. First is SD RAM. It's a little bit older, and I don't have any SD RAM here. Must have used it in the lab somewhere. But SD RAM would look just like this, except for that you see this notch right here? There'd be two notches on it. Okay? there'd be two notches, one right here and then one right in the middle. Put that there. And I do have a motherboard here that uses SD RAM. Nope, I guess I do not. Must be with the RAM in the other room. And the banks would actually have two notches on it as well. So if I draw it, it would look something like this. A notch, then another notch, and then it would come up like that. Okay. And then, you know, you'd have your triangle packages with the soldering right on the sides like that. Okay, package, soldering, soldering, package, soldering, soldering, and so on. And then the book's gonna go over, you know, how many pins they are, the compatibility and so on. And then the banks would look something like this, except for there'd be two little notches on it. Okay. Now when they talk about pins, they are talking about these little copper connections right here. SIM, have you heard of SIM, single memory? Okay. SIM, the connections, there's are only on one side. Okay, they're not on both sides. They're just on one side right here. If there is a pin on this side, it's the exact same one on the other. They're the same pin. If you connect in the back, connect in the front, connects to the same place. In DIMM, each pin is separated. So if you want to know how many pins this had, you could actually count all these copper pieces, multiply it by two, and that's how many pins you've got on this piece of memory. All right, so SD RAM is something that you probably will no longer see in the field. What I just passed around is DDR. DDR has only one notch, but it has the same triangular packages going across this way. So it looks the same. And then, you know, the books can go how many pins, the compatibility, because RAM is actually a whole can of worms. We'll go through the labels in just a little bit. I'm just kind of explaining the types. DDR means double data rate, which basically means that it goes two times as fast as the previous one, SDRAM. Okay? Technically, DDR is also SDRAM. They'll call it DDR SDRAM. But most people just call it DDR so that they don't have to repeat the SDRAM every single time. But it's all SDRAM and it's all dual memory. Then the next one is DDR2, which I'm going to pass around now. DDR2 now also has one single notch on it. And if I line it up with the DDR, you notice that the pins do not line up. They're actually uneven. And if I spin it this way, they are barely off. Again, they do not line up. They're just one placement away from each other. Okay. The other thing you'll notice, the difference between these two is what?
The
packages, right? This package right here is this long rectangle with a soldering on the side. If you notice, this one's pretty slick. It's all squared and there's no soldering on it. This looks a lot like the processor, where the connection points are in the bottom, so that once it connects, all you see is the top of the package. You don't see any soldering points. It basically works like this, where all the connections are in the bottom, so that when you connect it, all you see is just a clean package all the way around. Okay. Now those packages, each one of those packages will sometimes be labeled of how big it is. Can I borrow this for a second? For instance, this piece of RAM is 128 megabytes. That's pretty small. SDRAM, DDR RAM, sorry. This DDR stick only has packages on one side. That doesn't mean anything necessarily, but what it does mean is that if I take 128 and divide it by 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, it will tell me the size of each one of these packages. Okay? And you can do it reverse too. If you lose the sticker and you want to know how much total RAM you've got, you could find how big each one of these are, and then just multiply it by as many packages as there are. Okay, and then I'll tell you the size of that stick. Okay. All right, now DDR2 doesn't mean that it goes twice as fast as DDR, but rated to SDRAM. Okay, everything's rated back to the original SDRAM, not from the predecessor. Okay, and then there's DDR3. Now, unfortunately, with DDR3 physically, if you look at it, it looks exactly as DDR2. It even has the same number of pins and everything. Okay, so physically it's kind of harder to tell DDR3 from DDR2 because the packages are the same. There's still one pin, number of pins are the same. Now, one thing you can tell on the boards themselves is if you look at it, you can pretty easily tell if this is for DDR or SDRAM or DDR2. If it's for SDRAM, you'll see it, or SDRAM or DDR, you'll see that these little holes right here are much coarse. They're pretty wide, and they're separated pretty far from each other. Okay. If you compare it to DDR2, you will see that these little holes are much smaller, and they're a lot closer to each other. Okay. And then obviously the last thing would be the notches. If you only see one notch, that's DDR. If I saw the coarse connections with two notches, that would be SDRAM. If I saw these close, tight-knit connections with just one slot, that's either DDR2 or DDR3. Okay. So you can tell just by looking at it as well. And you can hold them side by side, and you can probably see the space between them and the sizes of it. All right, so now let's talk about the sticks themselves. Now, RAM in general, it's part of the speed of the computer. If the processor is the brain, that's how fast I can think, the RAM will be the legs. That's how fast I can run. Okay? Together, they make the computer fast. If you can think really fast, you know, let's say you're a runner, right? You're a distance runner. You might have a good brain, you know the shortcuts, but if you can't physically get there that fast, that's not going to serve you much purpose. Or backwards, if you're really fast on your legs, but you keep running in circles, you're never going to get to the end line. It's not going to serve you either. So you need them both to have a fast computer. You need both good processor and good RAM. So the RAM, what we've got here first, once again, that's the MFG. That's just the manufacturer. That's all that is. Next, what we want to look at is this part right here, 2 gigabytes. Which means, actually this we'll come back to in a second. Let's go to this one. 1 gigabyte DDR, that's the capacity. That's again, how much can I think at one single point in time? Okay, that's how fast it can think. Or how much, I guess, let me find a better analogy. RAM would work better as a desk, actually. If you think of RAM as a desk. If I was the processor, the desk would be my RAM. My hard drive would be my filing cabinet. So data would be the papers in the filing cabinet. Okay, you with me so far? So I've got my filing cabinet, and I've got data inside my hard drive. I've got papers, Word documents, whatever, inside my filing cabinet. And if David was the user, he'd request, I need to open this document. I need to open up last year's inventory report. So he would send a request to me, the processor. I would go to my hard drive, my filing cabinet. I would find the document, and then I would give it to David. Okay. Well, now, when David is ready to look at something else, I'm going to take that document, and I'm just going to cache it right here on my desk. I'm not going to put it back in the hard drive. The reason is that if he wants to see it again, I'm just going to grab it off my desk and give it to him. Okay. So this is kind of like a temporary memory. It's not forever. Forever is the filing cabinet. You know, when at the end of the day, when I turn off the computer and go home for the day, you know, that processor is going to put everything back in the hard drive, back in the filing cabinet. That's the permanent memory. This is the temporary memory. This is just for now, while I'm working. Except for that, you use your desk more than just to put your documents. You know, you put your pencils and your computer. You put everything on your desk as you're working. When you turn on your computer, your RAM is the desk. That's everything that you need to work for that day goes onto your RAM. And then from your RAM, you work. You don't actually work out of the filing cabinet. That's actually there for you to pull stuff to your desk. When you're actually working on it, you put it on your desk, and that's where you work from it. The bigger your desk is, the more papers you can lay side by side and grade at the same time or check at the same time. So the more RAM you've got, the faster you can work. Does that make sense? All right, so this right here would be the capacity. That's how much I can put down and work at any single point in time. So obviously, more capacity would be the best. The bigger your desk are, if I had all of these desks to work, I would put papers all the way across, and I could just walk, go check, 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 check. Sorry, X. Check, check. No, I'm just kidding. but I could work much faster. All right. Next, what we've got on this list is the PC400. And unfortunately, it's missing a piece here. Not all stick labels have the exact same information. Let me see if this one does. This one does. This one's a PC2100. This is a PC4000. But this stick that I'm holding in my hand is a PC2100U. That's the PC speed. Oh. The PC speed is related to the frequency. The frequency of this one is 266 megahertz. And they'll always be related. Some sticks will have the PC speed, some sticks will have the frequency. And it just depends on what your stick has, how you can label it. But your computers will have, the motherboard will have specifications of what kind of RAM it can take. Your motherboard might say, I can only support PC2100 RAM. So you have to go out and get PC2100 RAM. Or it might say, I can only support 266 megahertz RAM. So you have to get 200 megahertz RAM. The good thing is that they're related, okay? 2100 will always be 266 megahertz, okay, and so on. So that's the good thing. The bad thing is that not all motherboards will be labeled correctly. But whenever you do get a motherboard, you have to make sure you have the right type of RAM that that motherboard can take. It either be in the manual or in the box when you first buy it. If you're going to upgrade and put more RAM into this computer, you need to match this. A lot of people worry about just matching the capacity. You need another 1 gig stick, but that's actually less important than matching the speed of the stick. Okay. I actually prefer having faster sticks with less capacity. That's if I had a choice between more capacity and a slower stick, or fast capacity and not so much capacity, but a faster stick, versus vice versa, I would go with the faster stick. The reason is, this is how much I can think at a time, but this is how fast can I send data to the RAM and take it down, okay? So if I've got a really big disk, which is my capacity, I have 10 gigs or 8 gigs of RAM, but me putting stuff on the disk, that would be the speed. If the speed is really slow, then all that RAM is not really serving its purpose, okay? I would rather have really fast RAM and less than have a lot of RAM that's slow. Okay, that's just me personally. Because most of the time you won't even use all that unless you do something very, very specific. Okay, so the speed's always important. They'll either be labeled by the frequency or by the PC speed. But each stick would have one or the other. This one actually happens to have both. All right, so that was the speed right here. All right, next what we've got is, let's look at this, the cache latency. Luckily for us, we don't have to worry about the cache latency anymore. Back in the days, motherboards were very specific, and actually, a lot of my earlier service calls were just RAM issues, just so many different RAM issues, because everything had to match. Your cache latency had to match your motherboard, your frequency, your voltage. This one has a voltage, you notice that? Has a voltage on it. This actually was a big deal back in the days. You put the wrong voltage of RAM in your motherboard, and you just fried your motherboard. Not the RAM, but the motherboard. Like I said, it was a big deal. Now, it's all regulated. The cache latency and the voltage, nobody even knows that exists because the motherboards are so diverse that not only can they handle many, many different types of speeds, this is all standard now. Okay, there isn't different voltages in RAM anymore. The last couple numbers are not to worry about. That's specific to the manufacturer. The last thing we're going to look at is this right here. Okay, this is a part of a kit. Okay. If I had this motherboard right here and I needed to buy RAM, how many sticks can I put in here?
Three,
right? And that's it. I can't put four. I can only put three. What if I had two sticks in here that were 2 gigs each, and I needed two more to have a total of six? Okay. When I go shopping, on the categories over here, I'm gonna say that I need to see 2 gigabyte sticks. Okay. Unfortunately, some websites, they won't show you a single stick that is 2 gigs. They will show you a kit, and a kit means this is 2 gigabytes inside of two sticks, which means each stick is 1 gigabyte. Does that make sense? So would that work for this? No, because I only got one slot left. I need to make sure that it says one stick of 2 gigabytes, not two sticks of 1 gigabyte, or so on. So just be careful with the labels here, the 2X, 1X, and so on. The first number will always tell you how many sticks total, okay? That's how many sticks are gonna be. So if I say I have 4 gigs of RAM, 2X2, what does that mean?
Two sticks
of 2 gigs each, okay? So if I need 8 gigs of RAM, and I have 4 slots open, okay? I need 8 gigs of RAM, and I have 4 slots open, what can I look for? What can I shop? What kind of kits can I get? 4X2, I can use that. 4 sticks of 2 gigs each. What else can I use? Two sticks of 4 gigs. And the last one is? 1 stick of 8 gigabytes. So one single stick that's 8 gigabytes total, 2 sticks that are 4 gigs each, and then 4 sticks that are 2 gigs each. Okay, so that's how you read these numbers right here. Any questions with RAM? No? I kind of need some more space to write on, so I'm gonna erase this. Another thing on RAM that I want to talk about is, I kind of already hit on it a little bit, but is pairing up RAM. RAM is best works in pairs, and if you notice, in the RAM world, it always doubles up. There's a 128 megabyte stick, there's a 256, there's nothing in the middle, okay, because double of 128 is 256, right? There's a 512, because that's double of 256. There's nothing in the middle, no single stick that's in the middle. Then there's the 1 gigabyte stick. 1 gigabyte is actually 1024, because that's double of 512. But we just call it 1 gig for ease of use. And then there's a 2 gig stick. Is there a 3 gig stick?
No.
What's the next stick that exists?
4.
Is there a 6 gig stick? No. The next stick that exists? 8. Okay. So it doubles up every single time. Whenever you start looking at multiple sticks of RAM, you will have something called dual channel, which enables that RAM to work faster. If I have 2 slots on my motherboard and my motherboard supports dual channel, then I want to get 2 of the exact same sticks side by side, and then the RAM will actually disperse the work, the motherboard will disperse the work across both, and they will both work twice as fast, okay? Because they will actually be solving equations back and forth like this, okay? They won't be like, you do one, when you run out, I'll do the rest, okay? They're actually working together to work faster. So there's triple channel and quad channel. The more that you have, the better. Sometimes on a motherboard, you will see it like this. This is my triple channel here. And then the coloring would be on these pieces right here. There'd be a red one, a blue one, a red one, a blue one, or, you know, a brown one, a light brown one, a brown one, a light brown one. But they'll color it, the coloration will be different. This is telling you that if you put 3 of the same sticks in these specific slots, the triple channel will automatically turn on and make that RAM work even faster than it's supposed to, okay? And then if you get 3 more that are exactly the same and you put them in these slots, the triple channel will work together and get that done. The coloration will sometimes look like this. 1, 2, and 3, and then 1, 2, and then 3. And in this scenario, you've just got to put the first 3 here and then the second 3 there. Okay? If they're all black, sometimes they'll be labeled like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And when I mean labeled, I mean literally, when you look at this, And let me find it right here. You see DDR1, DDR2, DDR3 written right on there. Okay? And then sometimes it'll be labeled like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Don't think that they don't know how to count. That just means that they're in those channels. Okay? And they'll be all black except for that the numbers would jump around like that. That's telling you that the channels are like that. If it was just the door channel, I can have... And I can have two types of numeration. I can either have this, or I can have this. Okay? And depending on the numbers is how I would put my pairs of memory. Okay? All right. Moving along. Motherboards. Now, motherboards looks like this, has many different parts to it, and the way you classify this is in conjunction to the parts that it uses. For instance, AT motherboards will have certain CPUs that it can use. It will be certain types of RAM. ATX will have certain CPUs that it can use, certain types of RAM. ATX2 will always have PCI Express, and ATX will only have AGP video cards. Okay, so there's a lot of little components that identify what type of motherboard it is, but I'm gonna give you the easiest one to remember. Okay, the easiest one to remember, believe it or not, is through the power supply connection right there. If your motherboard has only a single 20-pin power, just one connector like this that's 20 pins and that's it, that's an AT motherboard. Okay, so if it has 20-pin power, like this one actually is an AT motherboard. The physical size actually has nothing to do with it, believe it or not. But if this right here only powers up with this 20-pin connector, known as P1, this is an AT motherboard. That's the easiest way to tell what kind of motherboard this is. It's known as P1, this connector. An ATX is exactly like the AT, except for that you added the X, right? The X means that you need auxiliary power for your processor. That's what the X means. So an ATX motherboard would have P1 that looks like this, and then another little connector that has only 4 pins. And that auxiliary is for the processor. The better processors will require more energy. So now ATX has P1, which is a 20-pin connector, and a 4-pin auxiliary power. Okay, that's an ATX motherboard, regardless of the physical size of it. Next, we have ATX2. Now, you know, like I said, components started getting better, RAM started getting better. ATX2 motherboards have DDR2 or DDR3 RAM. They no longer have this AGP slot. They have PCI Express and all sorts of stuff. But once again, the easiest way to tell an ATX2 motherboard is by the power connector. The ATX2 motherboard is exactly like the ATX, except that it has an additional 4 pins on the side. Okay, so it has a 24-pin power connector, which we'll call P2, and the 4-pin auxiliary power. Right? And this is actually the best way to identify a form factor for a motherboard. Not really the size of it. That just means you got to get a case that can physically fit this motherboard in it. The best way, the easiest way, I should say, to identify it is through the power supply. Just look at the power supply. If it has 24 plus 4, it's a ATX2. If it just has 20 and that's it, AT. And if it has 20 plus the 4 auxiliary, ATX, okay? All right. Now that we've kind of identified the form factor there, let's talk a little bit more about the motherboards themselves, because the motherboard I tend to see as one of the most important pieces of your computer. I actually call the motherboard the computer itself. So if I take this motherboard, looks like that. You see I've got my connection for my processor right there. I've got my RAM right down here. You notice this one has 2 yellow ones. Why would there be 2 yellow ones there? For your dual channel. If you put one here, and then the other one on this blue one, your dual channel is not going to kick on. You need to make sure you put them on those 2 yellow ones. Okay, and if you've got an oddball that's different capacity, I'd put that on the blue one. All right. So that's the memory slots right here. You see I've got PCI slots right there. Mine are blue. Those are yellow. Color doesn't mean anything here. That just means they decided to use that type of plastic. That's it. I have my AGP slot. Mine is kind of a tan. That one's brown. Once again, color has nothing to do with it. And then I have my BIOS. In this case, mine is right here. I have my North Bridge. You know that North Bridge will always have a little heat sink on it. I've got my South Bridge way down here. I've got my connections for my IDE, my hard drive. And this one doesn't have SATA, all right? But that's how it physically looks. Now, internally, the way this works is that your processor, or your CPU, there's a front side bus we're talking about, is connected directly to your North Bridge. So in other words, the connection from here to here is your North Bridge. On your North Bridge, you've got two connections besides your processor. You've got your RAM right down here and a PCI Express or AGP slot, which is the high-end video connection. That's the only thing connected to the North Bridge. The North Bridge is then connected to the South Bridge. Yes, because it gets hot, because of the amount of work, yes. Because if you notice, everything funnels through the North Bridge. You could think of the North Bridge as the bodyguard for the CPU. It needs to go through the North Bridge first. All right, so the North Bridge connected to the South Bridge. Sorry. North Bridge connected to the South Bridge, and then everything else connected to the South Bridge. Your IDE, your SATA, your USB, Ethernet, audio, CMOS, everything is connected to the South Bridge from there, even your PCI cards. And that's usually why it doesn't have that heatsink on it, because it's just a tunnel, just a gateway to get to the North Bridge. That's about it, okay? The North Bridge handles all the higher end and faster processes for the motherboard, which is why it'll always have some kind of heatsink. Some of the older ones will even have a real small fan right on the North Bridge. I had a computer that I had to troubleshoot that was overheating. But the processor wasn't overheating. This was a photographer who had, whenever they set something called render, when they set the computers to do effects and export, it would overheat and shut off. So she took it to Fry's and they sold her the super big heatsink, and it still kept doing it. So I got there and I touched the heatsink. I said, this heatsink is fine. And I just accidentally hit it with the back of my finger, the North Bridge, and it almost burned me. And that's when I realized that the North Bridge was the one that's burning up. Because all that data travel that was going through the RAM and the processor. So what I did is I just put more fans on the case to allow more air to flow through. And then I put one of those little fans right on top of this guy, solved her problem. She didn't need that big giant heatsink that they sold her. Just so that you know, the way air should flow on a computer, and if this was the front of my computer and the back of my computer extended this way, air goes in the front, out the back, okay? And it needs to flow that way. If you ever put your hand in front of a fan and it's kind of pushing air out, then you put your hand behind the fan and it kind of sucks in, same thing. Just right here, you need to make sure that the fan is pointing into the computer so that it sucks air in the front and then pushes all that hot air out the back. If it has fans on the side, on the top, on the side, on the bottom, all that needs to be coming in and then out the back. All hot air goes out the back. Cool air comes in everywhere else. Okay. If you ever put your computer inside those old school desks that, you know, you open up a door and then you slide it in there and then you close the door and there's no ventilation hole, you're pretty much asking for trouble. Okay. Make sure that it's venting that hot air somewhere. Okay. I would go into the back and just cut a hole so that that hot air has somewhere to escape, or else that hot air is going to circle right back into the computer. Moving along, now we got to talk about connecting the front case to the motherboard. Whenever you buy one of these motherboards, they'll come with the manual, and the manual will tell you how to connect these little guys to the front. And the front of every case, you'll have a couple things. You'll have a power button to turn on the computer. You'll have a reset button, and this, when you hit that button, it automatically shuts it off and turns it right back on. It's like if you pull the power out of the plug, plug it back in and turn it back on. Okay, don't do that unless you absolutely have to. The newer computers, they don't even have this button anymore. And then it has two LEDs. One is green to make sure that the computer is running. It's just the on LED or the message LED. And then this other one, the red one or orange one or amber one, is for the hard drive. It's telling you whether the hard drive is thinking or busy or so on. Okay? All right. So now that we know what connections there are, and there they are right here, power button, okay, reset button. This is the on LED. And then this is the HDD LED. If you notice, this hard drive isn't thinking because it's not on. The hard drive is probably in sleep mode or something. Because remember, when the computer's working, it's not really working off the hard drive. It's working off the RAM. Okay, so that's why the hard drive is asleep at that point in time until it actually requests something from the hard drive. All right, so there's all my connections. And on my motherboard looks a lot like this right here. And you notice on the motherboard, there's all the colors right there. On the motherboard, you see that it just says front panel. That's it. Sometimes it'll say jumper one or jumper front panel one, or it would be labeled something in that neighborhood. In the manual, it will tell you something like this. It'll say front panel functions and then pins. Now, if you notice, this has numbers to it. And if we look at this right here, do we see a number anywhere written on the motherboard? A two, where?
Right there.
All right? What that two means is that that pin right there, that little copper pin, is pin number two. Because remember, that pin is sticking out towards the camera this way. So where would one be?
Below.
They will never number them side by side. You will never see one, two, three, four. It will always go one, two, three, four, either bottom to top or top to bottom. Okay? So that means one has to be down here. And the reason I explain that is because sometimes the only thing you will see might be this one here, and that's it. You won't see that two. Well, if one is here, would two be on top or would two be over here? On top. What if one, just what if one was right here? Where is two? Right below. Okay. If one was right here, right below. If one was right here, where would two be? Right on top. Remember, they always go up and down, up and down. All right, so now that we know how that works, let's count them out, and it looks like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Now, you notice that this 10 has a little square on it. What that's telling you that there is no pin there. You see how there's no copper pin right there? It's just missing. Another thing you might run into one day is that this would read like this. 13 right there in the corner. It won't even give you a 1 or 2. But if this is 13, where would 14 be? Where would 12 be? Nope, it'll be right here. Because remember, 11, 12, 13, 14. It has to be even numbers, so you know the even number would go right next to it. So if this is 13, that's 12, 11, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, and 1 is right there. And they do that sometimes. Sometimes, for some reason, they'll put like this number way at the end instead of the one. Just either because of space, I don't know why, but sometimes they do that. All right, so now that we know how they're numbered and numerated, we can actually look at this. And we see that it says hard drive active LED, and there's the hard drive right here, the button right here, or the LED, has cables that go out and look like this at the very tip. Okay, and if I hold this, you will see there's my LED. And coming out the back, I've got these two cables, the red and white. And then at the very tip of the red and white, it looks exactly like that. Okay? And it's actually written on there. It says HDD LED. And they'll always be written right on there. If not, just follow the wire up to where it connects. All right, so now that we see that it's written HDD LED, we see that there's two wires. The white will always be the negative. Okay? And the red would always be would always be the positive. It could be red, blue, green, orange, yellow, polka dotted, whatever. If it's colored as the positive, the white will always be negative. All right, so now that we've got our connector and we know that we have two holes here, that's the negative hole, that's the positive hole, I need to put that into my hard drive connection on connectors 1 and 3. So where is 1? The bottom, and where's 3? Right next to it. Like that. So I would actually connect that just the way you see it right there. Okay? So where is 2 and 4?
Right
What color are 2 and 4? For my power LED. So that would be this button right here, my on LED, also known as a power LED. I'll connect that on 2 and 4. So where's 2 and 4? The two green ones right there, because there's the 2, so that must be the 4. All right, the next is the reset switch. That's this guy right here. The reset switch goes on 5 and 7. Where's 5? What's that? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then 6 and 7. There it is. There's 5, there's 7. And then the last one is the power switch, goes on 6 and 8. The power switch right here goes to the red ones right there. Okay? Even though this pin is missing, you still count that as 10, because that place holder right there is 10. That's why they've got that 10 over there. These two you don't need to worry about. There'll always be these four. The newer ones will only have the 3, and that's it. Okay, the 2 LEDs and the power button. All right, now if we look at this a different way, sometimes the manual just doesn't come with your computer. That ever happened? You bought something, didn't come with a manual? Some motherboards will actually label it right on the motherboard, right on here. There's actually written right on there, just the way you see it right here. You see that we have active drive, hard drive plus and minus. Power LED, reset switch, power switch. Now, let's start with the hard drive LED positive. What's the pin number for hard drive LED positive? And the negative?
3.
All right, Kim, you've got the tough one now. Power LED positive, what's the pin number? How'd you know it was 2 and not 4?
Well, because 2 is on the top.
That's right, because the positive's here, so that means these are the positive.
And 4.
And then 4. And then the reset switch, that would be 5 for the positive, and the negative is?
7.
And then the last one, the power switch.
6 and 8.
6 and 8. Okay. So now we just wrote the manual this way. Another one kind of tough to see, and you see it right down here in the bottom corner. You see that it's labeled. It's actually 1 and 2 there, so you know that's 1, that's 2. So what would be this purple one right here? What number would that be?
9.
9, correct. 9. All right, so now that we know how to read this, I want you to look at this way. This row, this line going this way, all the way down to here, is this row right there. You see it? There's two rows right here, which means the top row is this top row. Does that make sense so far? All right. Make sense? Yes? Because you're going first. All right, so what's the pin number for power LED with the white cable? Somebody want to help?
8.
You get it? No, let's go backwards. Okay, this was a tough one. Let's go backwards then. Let's start with a hard drive LED with the red cable right here. What is the hard drive LED for this red cable right there? What pin number is it? Somebody?
2.
2? Anybody disagree? Anybody agree? Wow. David, do you know? All right. So let's look at this. We got hard drive LED, right? So right here are 1, 2, 3, 4 out of these 4. Where's the hard drive?
That would be 1.
Right here, right? And then we see the positive and the negative right there. We see that?
Yeah.
So this red row means it's this red row.
Oh, what's
you see it?
One, isn't it?
So the hard drive red cable goes where? Right there in the positive. Remember? So it's pin number 1.
Okay. And what you asked me earlier on, that should be number 8.
Okay, hold on. Stay with me. So not only do we see the plus here, if you look right on here, there's a plus sign drawn right on top of the connector itself. Is it right there? You see it? You see the little plus sign? See, there's a plus sign right there? It's telling you that's the positive side. Okay? So sometimes it's drawn down here, sometimes it's drawn right on top of it. One way or the other, it'll show you. So where does the HD LED white cable go? There's the white cable, the negative side, which would be pin number 3, correct. All right, so let's go to the next one. Where does the power switch black cable go? Nobody? Go ahead.
Six?
Anybody agree? Yes, it's the 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Because if you look at here, power switch, red cable goes on the positive right there, right? So that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Right on that orange plus right there. Okay? So what would the white cable for the power switch go? Well, first of all, not only do we have them side by side, we have colors, orange positive and then orange with no positive. So the power switch would go on the two orange. So that would go right there, which is pin number what? 8. Whew, God. Okay, moving along. So now the reset switch orange cable, where does that go? What's that? No, which one's the negatives? The white cables are the negatives. Okay, the colored cables are the positives. So now, anybody disagree? Anybody agree? Yeah, it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, correct. Reset positive goes right there where that plus sign is, right there. So what pin number was that? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Now, where does the reset switch white cable go? 5. So it would go like right there, right? There's a positive, there's the negative. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. All right, back to the hard one. You ready? Where does the green power LED cable go? What's that? It is 2. Wait. It is 2, yeah. It's right here. Now there's the trick. If you remember, I said it once really quick. Message LED is also known as the on LED or power LED. Okay, so that's why it has message on it. So the positive is right there, which is this 2 right here. Besides, did you just use the method of what's it called? Will you remove the what's not it?
Oh, process of elimination.
The process of elimination. I had a brain fart. Did you just use the process of elimination so that's the only one left? Yeah. Or did you know it was message?
Yes.
I guess. Okay. So then where would the white cable go? 4. Right there. Okay. Now I want you to notice this. You see how this block is one single block, but the power LEDs are split open. They're two individual connectors, kind of like this one is. And I'll pass this one around so you can see them now. That's an individual connector. The reason it has an individual connector is because there were some motherboards that would have the connector for the message LED or the power LED side by side. And that would be perfect if it was two individuals, or if it was one solid, connector, positive and negative there. But there are other motherboards that have the connector like this, and there's a space in the middle that's not being used. Here's the negative, here's the positive. So if you had a connector like this, that there were two of them side by side, it wouldn't fit. So the reason it's split in half like this is so that you can just separate them and plug them into the two accordingly. Okay. There's some motherboards that are universal that are having like this, positive, negative, negative, all for the power LED. And you'll say, well, what's the purpose of having that? It's so that you can, if you did have this, you just plug it in there. And if you have this, you just plug it in there. Okay? It's kind of like a universal motherboard. All right. Any questions with the front panel and the buttons? The good thing is that if you ever accidentally plug in the positive and the negative backwards, it won't work, but it won't fry anything. All you got to do is just take it out, flip it around, put it back in. So if you put your computer together and you see that your message LED isn't blinking, but the computer's on, so it should be blinking, then you probably just plug them in backwards. Just take them out, flip them around, put them back in. Okay? If your button works, the button's pretty universal. But if the button doesn't work, just flip it around, put it back in. That's it. Now, don't put the button in the message LED and then push the button, because that's actually going to spark. Okay? Just be careful with that. All right, next. Now troubleshooting, and we're down to the last slides. When we're troubleshooting, you always think back to these bare minimals. One thing I didn't cover was the power supply. We'll cover that a little later, different lecture. Power supply, you just got to get enough watts to power up all your devices. All these devices have volts and watts on them. When you buy your motherboard, the manual will tell you it uses 5 watts, 2 watts, 3 watts, whatever, 10 watts, depending on how big your motherboard is. Your processor is going to use another 2, 3 watts, you know, and so on and so on and so on. Add up all your watts, physically just 1, 2, 3, add them all up. You have 200 total, you've got to get a power supply more than that. 300, 400 is all fine. Just don't get power supply with less wattage than adding up your hard drive, your peripherals, everything one by one. Okay? Now, so we're not going to cover it a whole lot right now. We're going to get into that a little later. But right now when we're troubleshooting, these little pieces that we just talked about, the processor, heatsink goes with the processor, RAM, motherboard, and power are the only things you need for the computer to run. The button just to turn it on, to boot. After that, you can take the button off. You actually don't need it on there the full time. Actually, in my bench, I would have a button, just the button by itself and the wire, because I would plug it in, turn it on, and just remove the button when I was troubleshooting. The way this works is that using these little bit of components, you can troubleshoot the hardware. If I ever get a computer that they bring in and you push the button and it either turns on and turns right off, or if it doesn't turn on at all, or if it starts turning on and then goes out, I actually remove everything except for these components. Okay? And most importantly is one stick of RAM. Only one. They have 4 in there, I remove all 3 of them except for one, because when you start messing with the dual channel and compatibility, it could throw everything into hoops. So actually, when troubleshooting, I remove all the memory sticks except for one. And then once I get it running, then I start adding the other memory sticks. Okay, I never try to troubleshoot with more than one stick of RAM in it. That's why I've got the only one. Using these very little components, that's all your computer needs to run. We don't have time, but usually I would actually just grab the motherboard, the processor, the RAM, and a power supply and turn it on just the way you see it, and we'd be able to get into the BIOS and it'd boot and everything normally. You don't even need a case, believe it or not. The way the boot process works is when we're troubleshooting, we think in this format right here. The first thing foremost is the power supply. That's the power to the computer. If you plug it in to the wall and you hit a button and nothing turns on, no message LED, no hard drive, the fan doesn't spin, there's no power at all, there's your problem right there. Your problem is your power supply. Because not even the fans are spinning. The fans are supposed to spin no matter what. No matter what temperature the computer is, the fans should be spinning. Okay? At least this fan right here, the CPU fan. Next, let's say you plug it in and it turns on, all the lights blink, the fans spin, you know, it looks like there's power in it, but there's nothing else besides that. It goes down this way right here. When you turn on the computer, the power turns on, and then it turns on to the motherboard. The motherboard then starts doing something called the post, where it starts checking everything. It goes to the RAM, hey, or it goes to the processor, hey, you okay? I'm good. It goes to the RAM, hey, you okay? The RAM actually responds, beep, just sends one little beep out. And then it goes on to the next one. It goes, to the keyboard, believe it or not. The very next thing it checks is the keyboard, make sure the keyboard's working. You know, then it checks all the little other components, the PCI card, the PCI slots, the AGP slots, you know, everything else, one by one until everything's good. And then I put that one beep in there. So now, what I use, I actually use this very important piece right here to do my troubleshooting of my hardware. Okay, I use the keyboard and a little button called the caps lock. If at any point in time you hit the caps lock button and the light turns on, whether the light's built into the key or if the light's way up there in the top corner, if that light turns on, you did something. You sent a request from the keyboard to the RAM, to the processor. You know, obviously you need these to run. Right here. Obviously you need these to run. So it will kind of loop this way. You send a request from the keyboard to the RAM, to the processor, to the motherboard. And then guess what happened? It sends a response back to the processor, back to the RAM, back to the keyboard, and then it turned that LED on for you. So when the time you hit the button, you sent a request to the processor, and the processor sent a response back, and it turned on the LED. And by simply hitting the caps lock button, you just tested your RAM, your processor, and your motherboard all at once by turning on the light. If the light does not turn on, that means the process didn't get that far. It didn't go to the processor and back, which means there's something physically wrong with your computer. And I would troubleshoot it that way. If I turn on the computer and I hear a beep, just one single beep, that means it's good up until here. There's probably something wrong going down this way, either the keyboard, you know, my video card, my adapter, and this is actually a whole can of worms here, and we'll get to that in just a second. If I turn on the computer and I hear no beeps, my caps lock doesn't work, but you know, all the lights are on, it seems like it's working, then there's something wrong either with my RAM or my processor, okay? To be honest, the way they go out, it's kind of in this fashion here. The first thing that will usually break on your computer is going to be your power supply, just because it's regulating voltage, converting it from AC to DC, and so on. That's usually the first thing to break, because especially if you don't have it on some kind of UPS or power strip, that's the hard drives and the power supplies are usually the first things to go. Second thing to go would be your motherboard. Why? Because it's doing everything. That's the torso. Everything's connected to the motherboard. All the voltage is being regulated to the motherboard, all processes going through the motherboard. That's usually the next thing that goes out. Between these two, I've seen more RAM go out than processors. Usually the processor is the last thing to go out. Most of the time you can scrap everything except for your processor. Your processor should still be good, okay? So the way they go out usually is 1, 2, 3, and then 4. If the power supply is good, it's pretty simple. Besides the fact that they sell power supply testers that you just plug in your power supply, hit test, and it tells you yes or no, you can actually just see if all the fans are spinning, the lights are blinking, everything's turning on, that power supply is probably okay. If you don't hear the beep, it could be a RAM issue or it could be a processor issue. It could always be one of those two. Okay, if you do hear the beep, that tells me that my RAM is good and my processor are both good. If you hear the beep and you hit the caps lock button and the caps lock light turns on, you hit it, the caps lock turns off, that tells me everything's good. The problem then is somewhere else, is beyond the hardware, or at least the bare essential hardware. If you turn on the computer, the lights blink, you know, the caps lock button works, turns on, turns off, then there's probably a video card resolution. It could be that the computer probably got removed from a monitor, and the monitor had a resolution of 1920 by 1080. Okay? That was the resolution it was set, and you took that off and you put it on this cheap monitor, and this cheap monitor doesn't support 1920 by 1080, it'll only support 720 by 1280 by 720. Then that means that all you got to do is adjust your resolution again. Okay. Now, it could also be an adapter issue. If you had an HDMI and you're switching to VGA, sometimes you need to reset your video component. What I usually do, if one of these are the issues, I'll hit F8. When the computer's turning on, it'll boot up to the menu, and then I'll choose VGA mode, enable VGA mode. With enable VGA mode, it forces your computer to go down to 640 by 480. And that's the smallest resolution that it can probably do. And then if that turns on, then you can just adjust your resolution to the monitor that you have. Besides that, it could be your cable. Believe it or not, cables do go out, and I've seen them go out. Another one that I've kind of seen, is kind of rare, but I've seen quite a bit, is the input on the monitor itself. If you've got a monitor that has DVI and VGA, and the cable that's going to your monitor's DVI, you just got to make sure that the input on your monitor says DVI as well. Okay, that actually has happened more than you would think. And then the last thing is that your monitor is physically not working or not powering on. Just make sure that the light on the button bezel is working to make sure that your monitor is on. Because even here at the school, I've had times where I've got called over and it's just that the monitor was turned off or that the cable came loose. Okay, but if you see the caps lock button working, your problem is somewhere else. It's not in these bare essentials. The computer's working. If you can get to the caps lock and you've got some kind of monitor attached, you can get to the BIOS. And if you can get to the BIOS, that tells me that all the hardware is good. Okay, the problem's in the software. If you can get to the BIOS and you see the Windows screen and then it goes black, that's a Windows issue. That's a software issue, totally different from hardware. Okay. Any questions?